morning, church. Buenos dias. Well, we are in the final sermon for this sermon series on worship. So my hope is that you now are better worshipers than you were last month as you continue worshiping God. Because this idea of worship is everything is about Him and not about us. So we are going to continue reflecting on this passage on Romans 12 as we dive more deeply into this idea of maintaining God's presence in every aspect of our lives. So when we go back to the scriptures, let's read it together. It says, mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. So this is a very powerful teaching from Paul to the church in Romans. And when we see the context of this passage, so first, God is speaking to the church in Romans about living for God and focusing on God. But also in Romans 11, the context there is the inclusion of the Gentiles in the plan of God, in the God's plan, but also this idea of mercy in salvation and beyond salvation. And then in Romans 13, you're going to see that he continues encouraging us to submit to governing authorities, something that is hard to do today in America. But at the end of the day, what God is saying is that all authority have been established by God. Either we like it or not, every authority in every country has been established by God. And us submitting to the authorities and loving everyone and living in a way that is honorable to God is what God expects from us as Christians. So when we talk about the first part of this passage, it talks about the motivation for worship. And it says, in view of God's mercy. And the brilliant, important principle in this passage is that the motivation for our worship should not be our emotions, but the motivation for our worship is the understanding and the revelation of God's mercy. So we don't worship God because we want to, because what he did yesterday, he provided and he protected us. Most importantly, the reason we worship God is as a response to God's mercy. God is so powerful, he's loving, and everything, when we worship him and we make him the center of our worship, he embraces us, and he's always pleased with our worship. You know how hard it is to worship God, and as he flows through us, then we can be free to actually love others and please others in a healthy way. Now, the unhealthy way is when we are not worshiping God, when we are not flowing in the spirit, we're walking in the flesh, then we have all this brokenness where we start pleasing people instead of pleasing God. This need to be liked by others and to please people, and you don't have the ability to say no. Everything is giving, 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 because you want this person to be pleased. By now, I'm 50. So I know that it's impossible to please people. How many of you know that? Okay. You can try that when you are 15 and 20, but then after that, you realize really quick that there is no way. So there is a story about a guy got up in the morning, he was mad, he was angry, and his wife said, honey, I'm going to cook breakfast for you so you cheer up. And he said, okay, do whatever you want. So she went down the stairs, cooked breakfast, and she said, what do you want, honey? She said, I want two eggs. Okay, I want two eggs. She said, okay. She cooked the eggs, and I said, how do you want it? I want one scramble and one over hard. So she did that and came back running to the bedroom, excited, and said, here you are. And then he was mad again. And now she said, what happened, honey? And said, you scrambled the wrong egg. So when people want to be mad, you can do anything to please them and take them from where they are. So people have to decide to be happy and to be excited about life and things like that. Only God can fill that voice in our hearts. Only God can bless us. Because in that revelation, what he did on the cross, in his mercy, in his love, with that understanding, now you can worship. Now you can allow the Holy Spirit to permeate our daily activities. Everything we do, our relationships, everything comes into alignment in a healthy way. The differences between codependency and Christianity is when people are codependent, everything they do to please other people because they want to be liked or loved by other people. When you are a true worshiper, then codependency goes away because now you can worship God and now he filled that void and now you're healthy to love other people. And believe me, your ability to say no will be easier when you are secure on who you are in Christ. Now, the second point of this call from Paul is the calling. So what is the calling that he's making in Romans 12? So first he says, I urge you, it's an urgency, I urge you to offer your bodies as what? Living sacrifice. And the idea here is connecting the style of worship with the Old Testament. When we used to kill animals and these sacrifices were dead, and then the Bible says in the Old Testament that when God smelled that odor, he said it was pleasing to God. And I am a veterinarian doctor, and I know, and many of you know, that if you burn as animal skins and bones, it's not pleasant. The smell is strong, and it's not pleasant. However, for God it is. And then I ask, okay, why this odor, why this smell is pleasant to you? And the answer is simple. When God sees the earth and he sees these sacrifices, it's the smell of death. And why the smell of death is important to God? Because only when we are dead to our flesh, only then God can receive you. That's why, you know, this song about bye-bye, fly away, that's the happiest day of you, because then you are dead to your flesh. Your flesh is not a problem anymore. Now your flesh is out of the way, and now you can worship God freely. But if you go to a funeral home, and you see a guy lying there, and you say, you are stupid, the guy keeps, I don't love you, and he goes, you are never here, okay? You can threat, you can do anything when a person is dead. So imagine if you are dead to your flesh. It would be so easy to resist the temptation to give an answer to everything you hear, to defend yourself for everything that people say. When you are dead to your flesh, then people can say whatever they want, I'm dead to my flesh, I'm going to worship God. And if I'm feeling tempted to respond, especially people in Kentucky, there's a lot of passion and fire, because this is, you know, Kentucky are like Hispanics, you know, it takes time to go inside. After you go inside, people love you and awesome, but they look at you like, wait a minute, let me see what you're going to do first. And then I'm traveling around the whole state, and there is this love and food and a lot of sweetness in the food. Hispanic people love sweet food too, and we have all of that. But at the end of the day, we only can respond to people in a healthy way when you are worshiping God and we are flowing in the Spirit and we die to our flesh. So God hears from heaven this smell, this odor to sacrifice and death, and then we come alive before in Christ. The third point here is the nature of true worship. And for the nature of true worship, we're talking about holiness, and holiness is pleasing to God. It's impossible to please God and to worship God without holiness. It's impossible to please God and worship God without faith. It's impossible to please God and worship God without love. That's the God that we serve. And when we understand that, then we can walk in alignment with the Holy Spirit, and then we can say to God, come, Holy Spirit. And I know that for you and for me, when we are in our best season, we're praying, we're fasting, we're reading the Bible, we're worshiping, we're giving, we are excited. It's so easy to worship when you are in your best state. And then something happens. Someone says something and you answer and you were angry and you don't want to forgive that person. Next time you come to worship, you're going to have a hard time worshiping. Because as long as you don't forgive and let go, you cannot worship. And then you say, okay, last Sunday I was excited, I was fly away and dancing, and this Sunday I cannot worship. Why? Why? The flesh is in the way. And that's a moment for you and me to stop and reflect and say, I need to remove this from my life so I can worship God in a holy way, which is in alignment with God's word and the Holy Spirit. And only then we can flow in worship. Only then we can embrace God and remove every obstacle and any obstacle that prevent us from loving and worshiping God. This fourth element in this passage of Romans 12 is the challenge. So Paul is challenging us. The Holy Spirit is challenging us through the scriptures. And he says, do not what? Do not conform to the patterns of this world. And this element here is key because it's about our mind. At this point, it's our mind. It's a renew your mind. And you have to work and resist the temptation. The moment you say, Holy Spirit, come, fill my heart, come into my heart, fill my heart with your presence, instantly you are saved. But then it takes your whole life to transform your mind, to renew your mind, to destroy all these patterns from all actions, all behaviors, all these flesh desires, all this tension, all the thing that you did in the past, the thing that happens to you, the lies that you have believed, and you have to transfer and shift everything so you can start worshiping God in a way that is in alignment with the scriptures. And you have to change your mind and embrace the truth. But this temptation of peer pressure, culture, to conform to the world, and what Christians are called in the 21st century is to take a stand and really separate yourself from the crowd. And that sometimes is not popular, but that's what God is saying. As long as our values are not compromised, as long as they are not asking, people are not asking us to change our commitment to Christ and to the scriptures, we can be friends with everyone. Especially, I'm not so worried about people, what they are doing or who, or what God or who they worship. As long as they don't ask me to stop being who I am and stop worshiping the God who saved me, I can be friends with anyone and everyone. But if you ever put me in the situation where I have to choose between Jesus and you, guess what? I'm going to choose Jesus 100 times 7. Because that's the only way we can live our life and be a beacon of light in the world. That's our goal. And that's why when Jesus says, I came to bring the sword and I will place mothers against daughters, fathers against children, it's not like he's going to break the family. He's saying that your mama, your daddy, everybody's okay as long as they don't ask you to go against who you are in Christ. If that happens, at that moment, you have to make a decision and resist the temptation and the pressures to fit, and instead of fitting, choosing to stand out as a beacon of light in the world. Then and only then, you can be what? Transformed. Your mind begins to shift. You begin to break all these blueprints, all these mental ways that you have from all your life doing things your own way. We have been walking with the flesh longer than we have been walking in the spirit. So our reactions, most of the time, is a response, it's a reaction from the flesh rather than being proactive in the spirit. And that tension really challenges us. Wow. That's my prayer. That's my prayer. How can I change my mind? How can I allow the Spirit to speak truth into my heart? Renew my thoughts. Renew my memories. The fact that the enemy is always trying to shift you to go back to your old ways, to be angry, to be frustrated, to not forgive. Remember what people did to you so you don't forgive. But in reality is that every time you ask God forgiveness, your past is erased by the blood of Jesus. Wash away. And even though the enemy is talking about things that you did, but I'm telling you, if you ask forgiveness in the name of Jesus and you believe that he died for you on the cross and your sins are forgiven, there is no records of your sins in heaven. There's no records, only in hell, because that's what he does. He accused us 24/7, but the books in heaven are clean. Are clean. No one can accuse you about anything, because God says, yes, we are all broken, our broken nature, we do things, but when we ask for forgiveness, even though on earth and in hell, because on earth, people that you affect with your actions or your emotions or your words, they will not forgive you so fast. So they still are in a process of forgiving you. Sometimes they do, sometimes they never do that. In hell, they have all these actions written every time you broke the law, every time you walk away from loving your neighbor, everything, accusations and accusations. But in heaven, it's clean. And there's no way to you, for you and me to go back to anything, because God is saying, what you're talking about? You have been forgiven. I remember when I don't remember. I will not remember your actions. That's my commitment to you. That's what God says. I will not remember. The enemy wants you to remember. God says, I will not remember. I will not bring to the presence the things that you did. Is that powerful? And then you can worship. And then you can be excited. Because even though our actions on earth are criticized by people, at the end of the day, what God is looking is what? Your heart. And God is after your heart. I've been saying that for 1 year. God is after your heart. Not your actions, your heart. And sometimes my actions can be sometimes not what people want. But what God is looking is not the outside. God is after my heart. And if your heart is in the right place, even though you have good intentions, you make mistakes as you serve other people, God is saying, you know what? Even though your actions are not right, your heart is. Even though your actions are broken because of your broken nature, your heart is perfect in me. And I'm looking at your heart. I'm after your heart. So even though people are having troubles and situations, and even in hell, the enemy have all these books about you, your heart is perfect. You have the mind of Christ. You are mind. You are blessed. Not that you are going to be blessed. You are blessed. You are saved. Now you're going to be saved. You are what? Saved. And when you are saved, then you can rest in that assurance, and that's the result that you have in the last piece of this passage. Discernment. Only then you can discern God's will. And sometimes I said to people, what are you doing? What do you know what God wants for your life? Yeah, I'm discerning what God wants for my life. Here is what I have to say about this, based on Romans 12. Before you are ready to discern anything, first you need to check your motivation, that your motivation is not emotional. Your motivation is God's mercy. Second, you have to respond to the call. What call? Offering your life, your agenda, your dreams, everything in you, putting in the altar as a living sacrifice. Third, you have this challenge. What challenge? The challenge to renew your mind and resist the temptation and spend time with God in the scriptures. And only then you are ready to discern. Because if you don't, you know what you're discerning? Your emotions. You know what you're discerning? Remember what this person did. You know what you're discerning? Remembering what she said, he did. Remembering your own pain, your own brokenness, your own insecurities. That's what you're discerning. You will be guided by your flesh instead of being guided by the Spirit. Wow. I want to be ready to discern. But I need for you to discern, you have to quiet all the voices. Because everyone wants something from you. Do you know what I'm talking about? Everyone wants a piece of you, something. people ask from you time, resources, attention, all of this, and here you are in the middle being pulled by everyone. At some point you have to say, that's it. I'm going to spend time worshiping. And even though I don't like what I'm seeing, I can still worship. Because as long as you are walking and praising and worshiping God and spending time in the Word, you will be fine. Just keep walking, especially if you are in a valley. If you are in a valley of life, you're going through trials and tribulation, keep walking. You might be crying, you might be angry, but keep walking, because this process of renewing your mind and being transformed is a journey. It's not a one-second thing. It's a journey. If you keep acknowledging Christ and saying, these emotions are not okay with you, but you know what? I know I'm not going to give up. I'm not going to give in. I know that you are with me. I know that you will touch me. I know that you are faithful. I know. And then you start walking and walking and walking. And then, before you know it, you are again in a mountain, worshiping God again, free of the noise, free of the pain. It's the only way, church. There's no other way. So what is my call to action? Make sure you start your day and you end your day with moments of intentional. Say with me, intentional. Say it like you mean it. You know why? Because everything around you will push you. You have to be very intentional if you really want to worship, especially when things are not going the way you want them to be. And you don't know what the day lays for you ahead of you. That's why you need to pray and you need to fast, because then you can face anything that comes at you. The difference is that things are coming to all of us. It's how we respond what makes a difference. And that difference comes through worship in prayer. That's the only way. 2, integrate worship into your daily routine by offering prayers, praises, thanksgiving throughout the day, regardless of what happens. So you will not give thanks for everything that happens. You will give thanks for in everything. So in the middle of the situation, some things are bad, but you still can say everything works for good for those who are called in God. So I know that there is a plan and I can hold it. I know salvation is around the corner. I just need to keep walking. Commit to regularly attending and participating in corporate worship. So don't stop worshiping. The house of God is about God. Worship is about God, not about my preferences. So if you come in here, forget about everything and just focus on God. Because when you make things about you, then that's idolatry. That's not worship. When you do everything about God, that's true worship. I'm going to worship God in spirit. Especially, you know, when you are a leader in the church, it's really hard to worship. And you have to really shut your mind, because the moment you go into places, you're evaluating the service, the music, this, that. And you have to say, no, time out. You're not here to evaluate. You're not here. You're here to do what? Worship. And then Monday, we can meet. If you don't like the chairs, or you don't like the light, and you don't like, we can talk about it, but Sunday is a time for what? For worship. Because these people, Kyle, all the team, they work really hard all the week to put this together for you, right? But most importantly, to present this as an offering to whom? To God. So when you come in here, the best thing you can do is, if we're having the boogie band, if we have choir, then we enjoy choir. If we have the band, we take the opportunity to worship God like never before. And then if we have something to say to Kyle, you don't like the music, let him worship. Then Monday, call him and let him know, rip everything. But at least he went to bed on Sunday knowing that he gave himself 100% to this. And then there is always room for improvement, yes? But first, Sunday is his time of worship. We all need to worship. I need to worship. I don't like the sermon. Especially when I get excited and passionate, my accent really goes to the roof. Okay? So, but let me know Monday about my accent, okay? Engage in worship together with other believers outside of the church. Find people to worship, to read the Bible together, to worship outside of the church. Let's read this quote from this church father together. 1, 2, 3. Amen. Amen to that. So as we conclude this sermon series, this is my hope, that we embrace this invitation to be transformed by the Holy Spirit. Let worship be a lifestyle in our life, so we are impacted, our families are impacted, and then the world is impacted. And everything we do for His glory. Let's pray. Let's pray, church. Can you stand for this prayer, please? Let's pray. Loving Jesus, may our life be a continual offering of worship in spirit and in truth, as we seek to honor you in all we do and reflect your glory to those around us. Let this next worship song be a time where we reflect and the Holy Spirit come down in ways like never before. So I'm going to invite you, church, as the band lead this song. I want to encourage you to close your eyes and really worship before we send you off. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
I count on one thing. Same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. And yes,
church, remember that next weekend, because of the Iron Man thing. Thank you. We're going to have our service on Saturday, 5:30. 5:30? Okay. One service, so come, please, let's worship together, and we're going to start a new sermon series on evangelism as a lifestyle. So come ready, and let me send you in the name of Jesus. May the presence of God dwell richly in your life as you live out a lifestyle of true worship, shining with his light and love for all to see. Go in peace in the name of Jesus. Amen.